Hi, I'm Jason Nichols, and I'm on the left.
And I'm Vince Colonnais, and I'm on the right. And if we can't find common ground in this world today,
then we're all just travelers.
Passing each other in an international airport.
In this great American experiment,
we'll be relegated to the trash bin of history.
So let's come together.
To debate without yelling. And let's save this nation.
Today, the legendary loser, R.A. the Rugged Man, on Vince and Jason, Save the Nation. Vince and Jason, Save the Nation is brought to you by Gold Co.
Why buy gold? Are you watching what's happening in the world today? The global pandemic, the U.S. debt piling up, spiking inflation, and the looming Biden tax plan. In the 2008 financial crisis, many Americans lost huge amounts of their retirement savings. So what are you doing now to protect your money? Well, many turn to Gold Co. It's the leading precious metals company in the United States and a five-time Inc. 500 winner. With an A-plus rating from the Better Business Bureau and thousands of positive customer reviews, you can trust the team at Gold Co. to help protect and grow your wealth. Go to goldco.com/save the nation to request your free IRA guide that will share secrets with you that financial advisors don't tell you about. So what are you waiting for? Don't delay and fall victim to another stock market crash, inflation hike, or dollar decline. Visit goldco.com/save the nation and get your free IRA guide today. If you visit goldco.com/save the nation right now, Gold Co. will give you up to $10,000 or more of free silver when you open a qualifying account. That's right, up to $10,000 in free silver. We thank Gold Co. for sponsoring this podcast. Now, back to the show. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Vince and Jason Save the Nation. Merry Christmas to you. Happy New Year. We got a big show for you today to close out 2021. Jason Nichols, what's on the deck?
Well, today we have one of my favorite rappers. I remember him from way back doing his thing. And one of the few rappers to get a Biggie cosign, R.A. the Rugged Man. R.A., what is heading for? How you doing?
How you doing, fellas? What's going on?
Chilling. You know, R.A., I got to say this. Like, and we'll get into the politics and all of that later. There's one thing that I've always had an issue with you with. And that's some of your boxing analysis. I remember watching a video where you approached Floyd Mayweather.
No, he approached me. I was on Shade 4-5 and we were talking boxing. And they said, what do you think about Floyd Mayweather? And I said, well, he's a great fighter, but he needs to step up the competition. And he called up the show angry. So he approached me. I was just there. He called up like, yo, fellas. And I said, well, hey, when are you going to fight somebody in the top three in your weight class, though, Floyd? So that's where, and then he, you know, egos fled and he stayed on the phone for 20 minutes. And, you know.
So. Yeah, I thought, because I remember hearing it and he was like, I'm in the back of the Maybach and like talking about trying to flex a little bit. The only thing that I disagree with was when you were like, you need to fight Shane Mosley. And I was like, I agree with Floyd there. I was like, Shane Mosley that got 5 losses?
No, that was one of the people. We said Paul Williams, we said Margarito, we said Mosley, we said them all. And, yeah. And it was good. Mosley was a guy, one of the top guys in the weight class at the time, even though he was older, yeah, and lost to Winky Wright and stuff like that. But he was one of the top guys, and he was a legitimate guy in that weight class. And Floyd went up, fought him, and, put on a clinic. So it was a beautiful thing. I didn't say that Shane would beat him. If you listen to the interview, I said, yo, you got to step it up and fight these guys, because if you don't fight them, you're destroying your legacy. And Floyd, that's the thing with Floyd. He's a businessman. You know, he's smarter than me business-wise. I come from the old school where boxers fought whoever was number one. They all fought the toughest right. challenges. Right. Floyd comes from a different school of like, hey, the minimal risk for the highest pay, which is smart. You know, so I'm like, oh, back in the day, everybody just fought everybody, you know, so he was coming from a different spin on it, you know.
Do you think Canelo Alvarez is doing that right now?
Yeah. And you know, I don't want to go bad mouthing the guy, but I just think that, you know, boxing's getting more and more corrupt. And I think, you know, his camp, 4 of the guys tested positive for PEDs and, you know, he tested positive for illegal substances and he's all of a sudden going up to 175 and now he wants to fight cruiserweight. I think there's a little shadiness going on there. You know, he got caught in the past, but I think because he's the money guy, they let him get away with it a little bit. But you know, the haters are gonna hate my guts for saying that. But I don't like it. I don't like seeing this guy go up to cruiser. You know, next he's saying maybe possibly cruiserweight, and he's the harder puncher, this little skinny guy. You know, so
yeah, I remember when he was fighting what, like 147. You know, now he's a cruiserweight,
and his fans are so delusional because they're all like, oh, he wasn't in his prime. He was just starting boxing when he fought Floyd. No, he had 42 fights.
Yeah, 40. I think it was 45.
I don't know if it was 40. I think it was 42, but it could have been 45. But Floyd had like 48 fights. Floyd's competition was higher. But, if you look at these guys fighting now, who's the big Russian guy? Burdabeev or whatever. He got like 19 fights. Lomachenko has what, 12 fights. These guys... So this guy had 42 fights, had championship fights. He was a champion, and they were all acting like he was green before. No, he wasn't. He had 42 fights against champions too, a lot of champions. So they just rewrite history to make their, to try to pretend like Canelo could have beat Floyd on his best day, and he couldn't have. We all know that.
I mean, you look at Teofimo Lopez, I think, has 17 fights, if I'm not mistaken.
Kambosos, shout out to Kambosos. That was a great upset and a great fight. Great fight.
Man. Yeah, but did you hear that? And I promise we're going to get to the politics, Vince.
It's all good. I'm listening to this and I'm like, obviously this is out of my wheelhouse. I love watching boxing, but I'm in no way familiar with it like you guys are. And I am thinking like it is interesting, like for you guys who are definitely seem like much more boxing purists, does it drive you crazy to see like the Logan Jake Paul kind of fights, like get all this attention and people buy pay-per-view to watch like guys who are like, you know, it's just like celebrity boxing matches. It's not the actual art form.
No, I here's the thing is, I don't get mad at them, because if somebody's going to pay millions of dollars to watch your fight, you're going to fight. I hate Jake Paul. I hate them. I hate the Logans. But how could you hate them? I mean, they're making money because the public is stupid enough, because they like sensationalism and celebrity stuff. It's the same thing in the music industry. People go off the celebrity personas and the fame and who got the money and this and that, rather than who's making the best music, who's got the magazine cover or this and that, who's hot for the week. Right. So, I mean, that's the game. That's what the game is, you know? It's celebrity culture. Look at Trump was the president. It's celebrity culture we live in. You know, Kardashian's one of the most famous people in the world. We live in celebrity culture. So Jake Paul is part of that, you know, and he's capitalizing on that, you know?
Right. I honestly don't have a problem with it. And you know what, honestly, and as you and I talked, Vince, you know that I've done a little bit of boxing. I've done a little bit of kickboxing. I've done a little bit of grappling, not good at any of it. But one of the things that I will say is like, I've always argued with a lot of dudes who do MMA that boxing is a different sport. Like, it's just a different sport. And a lot of these MMA guys are like, no, I can bang. I can go in there and fight. And it's like, you get in there with a real boxer, or even a dude who's not really a real boxer, you're going to realize that it's just a different game when people train just for boxing. And so I'm a fan of MMA. There's no question. I'm a fan of all combat sports. But the idea, I think Jake Paul is destroying this idea that just because you throw hard punches that you're a boxer. And so he's been beating up all these MMA guys. And it's showing that MMA is a different game. Like, you start throwing kicks in there, Floyd Mayweather's going to get knocked out in 30 seconds, you know, because it's a different sport, you know? And I think, so I appreciate that end of it. I like the promotion. I think Jake Paul is playing, he's doing exactly the same thing that Conor McGregor does and all those things, being the bad guy. And, you know, I like a good bad guy, you know, like Redman said, you know, the Red Mooley.
Well, that's what gets you to pay for it. I mean, honestly, that's what obviously gets you to pay for it, man. You see these like sensational battles on television. You see the way that they show up at the weigh-in, they're getting in each other's faces. You're like, all right, maybe I'll pay to see this fight. I want to see how this gets resolved.
But the start of Jake Paul was Conor McGregor, you know, this big celebrity match of this guy who never boxed before. And that was the start of Jake Paul. You know,
that's a good point. McGregor's a really good point.
And what you're saying about, like, you know, people have the tendency of looking at things that they don't do and thinking it's easier. Getting on the microphone, being an actor in a movie, writing a book, you know,
yes.
Getting in the ring with a boxer. Like, you know how many street dudes think, like, if I get in the ring, I'm a street dude. I could knock out that, but no, you can't. You know, so that's the thing. And
yep.
Boxer thinks he's going to get in an MMA ring and just tap the guy. And, you know, you always have a puncher's chance, but no, it is a different sport. And the MMA guy, oh, I'm going to go in a boxing ring and do, no, you're not, you know, unless you're fighting a washed up guy that can't take a punch anymore, you know, like, but.
Yeah. But I mean, James Toney tried to get in there, you know, and fight MMA once. Now, again, he was like 50 years old.
And that was Dana White's strategy. He wanted to, you know, take a crap on boxing and show how superior MMA is. Because, you know, but he took a Hall of Fame fighter. His who did James Toney fight again? The Hall of Fame guy. Who was it? It was one of the, you know, Hall of Fame fighters. Famous MMA fighter. James Toney went in there for his first fight. Never grappled. Never did that. Yeah. And if you watch James Toney's last couple boxing matches, he would stumble, fall down. Like he was out of shape. He smoked cigars. It was a way past his prime, Tony. So you put, look, this great boxer versus our MMA guy, and look, MMA superior. It's just, and then MMA fans go for that, but it's childish. Right. It's two different sports, bottom line, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right. No, definitely.
Put Michael Phelps on the track field and see how fast he runs, you know?
Right, yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Exactly. But I like to, you know, the promotion, it's kind of like, it's like the circus coming to town, and I really don't have a problem with it. You know, and I do think it was interesting. I watched Darren Williams fought Frank Gore, like a basketball player against a football player. Like, I do find those things kind of interesting. It goes back to the old principle of MMA. Before there was like actual mixed martial arts, like it was like karate versus kung fu, you know what I mean?
Like 450 pound guy versus the 180 pound guy. That was what was really crazy, man. They literally have like a 450 pound guy fighting like a different style guy that's 180 pounds. They had no rules at first.
Yeah. It was sumo wrestling. And then, you know, of course it was Royce Gracie who came in and changed the game with Brazilian jiu-jitsu, which nobody really knew anything about, and was choking out, was 170 pounds, choking out everybody, mm-hmm. and breaking people's arms. And then, you know, now that's just part of the sport.
The Gracies, the kids come out of their mothers and they got them training at like a year old. You know, the whole Gracie family got skills. They're born into that. They're fighting at 1, 2, 3 years old. They're training them, you know?
Yeah. Right. You know, I got to say, there's something kind of comforting about combat sports that still exists in our culture and people like it. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if you get this sense, but like, I feel like the idea that just men can go to war against each other inside of a ring or an octagon is a cool thing. And it's like, it basically says, yeah, okay, like that alpha component, the masculine component of society, it still exists and it's still valued, still cherished. And people like seeing it. They actually like, do you guys feel that way too?
Yeah, the thing is, I was pro. I lived my whole life with boxing. I was boxing when I was 8 years old. I was in the gym at 8 years old boxing.
Yeah.
My father raised me on boxing. I was a boxing guy. And when MMA first started, I was like, F that, boxing. You know, I was the old school guy. But, you know, what's crazy, as I get old, I get more sensitive and held back. You know, I got kids and all of this stuff, and you get older. And now I know a lot of champions, like world champions I'm friends with. And even the ones that weren't champions, it's like anybody that was a professional fighter,
mm-hmm.
when you actually talk to them and they're 40, 50 years old, every single one of them almost has some slowness to them, slur to them. Like, fast. It's really, you know, they're getting punched in their head and getting their brains destroyed for us, you know? And I'm not saying I don't mess with it and I don't like it, because this is what their lives were, and they wouldn't trade it for the world, and they loved it, and they loved every second of it, and they lived their life on their memories. So, but sometimes, like, when I talk to the older guys now, and I'm like, damn, like, his brain is all scrambled for us, because we enjoyed these guys punching each other in the head. So,
right.
You know, I'm pro boxing. I would never want, you know, them to take that away from them. But, you know, and it got a lot of people out the streets. It got a lot of people, you know, in a positive environment, in a gym where, you know, so... But it's like I said, when I got older and a little bit more like, damn, you know, 10 years ago, if you asked me, would you want your son to be a heavyweight champion of the world? I'd be like, hell yeah, my son, raise him to be the heavyweight champion of the world. And now I go, you know, the last thing I want is my son to be getting punched in the head for the rest of the world. You know, right. You know what I mean? And then as soon as he gets knocked out, everyone turns on him and he was never nothing. He's a has-been. And then he's living with this brain issue, yeah, getting punched in the head. So I love boxing and I, like I said, raised on it, but yeah, a little older, you think a little different sometimes.
Yeah, but you kind of see the same logic being applied to football. I mean, it's a different sport, head contact, head trauma different, obviously. But you see the same logic, you know, over the last decade, especially like there was this turn against football, especially for kids, where like, you know, as a society, we started saying, well, look at all the data the NFL's got. Look at the brain injuries. You know, you look at some of the guys who had devastating outcomes. What's his face who committed suicide, who played for the Chargers? I can't think
Junior
of his name.
Junior
Seau. Junior Seau. Yeah. I mean, you go down the list. And so there's this turn against it. And, you know, is that an overreaction? I mean, like is there an important place in society for physicality and encouraging kind of environments with controlled violence especially for young people to engage in it and to, you know, and well, I don't like to get something. Is there something valuable that they derive from it?
But how young are we talking? You know what I mean?
Your pick. I just think it does seem like there's an important role for this.
I just want to kind of piggyback off of what RA said. I agree with him. I do think that there is value in facing your fears. Like, that's why I got into boxing like, it's one thing to stand in front of a man eye to eye and have to fight him. And you're not mad at him. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's anybody can fight when they're angry. You know what I'm saying? Like, anybody can throw punches. You see girls throwing punches. But when you have to stand in front of a man and you're not angry or anything like that, but you have to stand there and take his punches and punch back, that's a different mentality. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you have to strategize. And I think that there's a lesson for that.
Is anger, as you mentioned it, is anger good in boxing or does it make you sloppy?
No, I think it's terrible. No. Yeah, no. It's the worst thing you can do.
Fighting off of emotion makes you lose a fight. It's a chessboard, man. You got to be on your chess game out there. You can't
see Floyd Mayweather angry. That's one thing. I've never seen him really angry. I mean, he acts a little bit.
The only time anger works is if you go out there the first round and you get lucky and you clip him. You know, but after that one round of anger or two rounds, you know, then you're doomed because the guy, okay, that anger didn't put me down, I'm good. And you're getting your head boxed off, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're on tilt and you're not thinking straight.
George Foreman said, you know, fear is one of the best things in boxing. He said when he fought Joe Frazier, which you saw, he annihilated one of the great champions of his time. But when he was walking out to the ring, he said his knees were shaking. Like, he was like this. And then as soon as he started throwing them bombs, bow, bow, you know, it destroyed Frazier, one of the greats.
Mike Tyson said the same thing. He said he was a great fighter because he was afraid. You know, yeah. I do think fear, it can work both ways. You know what I mean? Because if you're afraid, you get tight. You know, you got to be relaxed. You know, I remember seeing Evander Holyfield used to sing church songs in the back of the, you know, in the back. Like, he was just relaxing, you know, so that when he came out, it was like a day at the office. It's like, if you're going to interview the president,
mm-hmm.
you know, if you're there shaking because you're about to be in front of the president,
mm-hmm.
like, you're not going to give a good interview.
Right.
You know, you need to have that relaxed, like, it's another day at the office. And I think it's like that in life. So
I
think fighting is the same kind of thing.
I agree with you. And this is what I was talking about. It's like you get something, it literally punches you in the face. I mean, the lessons that are here in boxing, it's like, yeah, I don't know about you guys, but I do feel like fear of failure has been one of the greatest inducers of whatever success I've had in my life. So like that analogy that you just gave, interviewing the president, I've done that. I did that very thing. I did it three times. And each time I was scared that
humble brag.
No, but I'm telling you,
which president?
Trump. I interviewed Trump three times. And each time I was scared that like I would misuse the opportunity, that I would fail. And so I would go, I did extensive prep. I did like crazy prep. I thought through you talk about boxing, you probably think through punches and weaknesses and strengths. You think I thought through all of his answers. I knew in general which way he would answer, kind of like like the way that you know how Trump would intercept people, like he would like cut you off as soon as you start asking the question, as soon as you use like a proper noun that he has a brain thought about, like he would just start speaking. Right. So I tailored my questions down. You know, I made them so that I got right to the point, not a lot of like throat clearing or anything, because it's going to go off in some direction, on and on and on. But the point is, like, fear of failure, fear of losing, fear of getting your face beat in. I don't know. It just seems it's a good motivator.
Yeah. No, I agree. Go ahead, Ari. My bad.
That's it. Insecurities is what makes a lot of men great a lot of times. Yeah. Am I good enough? So you work to be better and better and better. And then, wow, it's great. You know, sometimes the confidence, oh, I'm already great. Sometimes that's the killer. You know, when you're good enough, you're already so overconfident. Sometimes you need a little insecurity to kick you in your ass and make you special.
Can I move? I want to move into your career as a rapper, because first of all, I should admit that, all right, I've been unfamiliar with you, unfortunately, because in preparation for this interview, I started like listening to some of your music, and it's like, first of all, you have incredible talent, I have to say. I know Jason already knows this. I'm preaching to the choir. You already know this, but the reality is I'm watching some of this stuff. I'm like, man, this guy's great. And actually I'm excited about it, because it means you've got a whole catalog of work that now I can finally be exposed to, which is cool. I really like the video that you got pinned to the top of your Twitter. It's a music video that you did called Firstborn, about your daughter. And I love that. I identify with it because I've got a 7-year-old daughter, and I could feel so many of the lessons that you have right there. How old's your daughter now, by the way?
It's going to be 6 in like 2 weeks, man. It's crazy.
6 years old. It's cool, man.
You know how fast it goes. It's crazy. You know,
I
want my little baby back. She's already 10 times smarter than her father already. She's, you know, correcting me at everything. All right, little girl, you got that. She's a smart kid.
Yeah.
My son will be 5 in February. So.
Well, I encourage people to take a look at this thing. I mean, it's a great video. It's on the top of RA, the Rugged Man's Twitter account. But I just want to ask you about your craft. Like, do you feel like you've gotten better through the years, through the reps? And how hard do you have to work at it, I guess, is the question.
Well, you know, it's a competitive sport, like boxing. If you lay down too long and you're not training, you know, the young kids are going to come up and whoop your butt. So you got to stay sharp. So yeah, you got to write as much as possible, you know, whenever you can, whenever your kids aren't jumping on you, whenever you're not out touring, whenever you're not, you know, you got to keep your pen sharp, like anything you do, you know? So, yeah.
How often are you writing? Are you writing just like all the time?
Well, my kids are away with their grandparents right now. So I've been writing like, you know, 15 hours a day, you know, cause then when they come back, you don't got time for nothing. Right. So, you know, as soon as they're gone, I'm my pen's on fire, you know? So, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Do you ever feel like I was listening to one of your songs, and you were like, you had a $1.8 million deal and it fell through. And I remember like the buzz about R-rated rugged man. And I look, I'm gonna keep it real with you, cause that's the only thing I know how to do. In the like late 90s, when cats would be like, there's this white rapper, I'd be like, here we go. You know what I mean? Like, it felt like there was like this desire to make white rappers great. You know what I mean? So, and you know, to be honest, a lot of us are real protective of the culture. You know what I'm saying? So, and then I heard you and I was like, all right, man, this dude is nice. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but in the early 90s, most people didn't even know I was a white guy, because there was no internet, there was nothing, and the tapes were weak, and they just thought, all right, a rugged man. And it was funny, one time I did a stage show, and my producer, Mark Niles, he was a black guy. He's the guy that discovered me when I was 16. And he was on stage hyping me up. And somebody was like, yeah. And Crustify Dibs, that was the alias. He brought respected rapper R.A. the Rugged Man on stage for credibility. You know, thinking Mark Niles, the black man, was R.A. the Rugged Man, you know. So none of that was my producer. I'm R.A. the Rugged Man, you know. But a lot of people didn't know I was white until, I think, closer to the late 90s. You know, that's when they started saying it, you know.
Yeah, I think that's when
Def Jam wanted, because I had a 9-label bid war, they all wanted me. And when Def Jam wanted me, they said, keep it a secret. and not show your face, because we're going to build up your credibility and let them know, yo, look at the man's skills. And then once they know, then we could boom, pop it off and R-rate a white guy. So, you know, that was, it was early in the game, you know, there wasn't too many on the scene. It was a handful, you know, MC Search, yeah. Beastie Boys before that, you know, stuff like that, you know, so.
And you didn't, the thing was, you never made your whiteness a gimmick. You know what I mean? Like, for example, I remember there was a rapper that I really liked. I thought he was dope. You may remember a rapper named Milkbone.
He was from right. Jersey. He was from
From Jersey. Kid was nice. I thought he, you know, I had his album. I thought, you know, Keep It Real is a classic.
It has a great beat and a flow on it. Yeah, Keep It Real.
Right. And that sample from Life's a Bitch, like, that was crazy. But the fact that his name was Milkbone, you know what I mean? And he made his whiteness like a thing, I think worked against him in the long run.
Well, that was also a thing too, because House of Pain blew up on Amanda Shear, Amanda Demi. I think she was helping manage them, and you know, they all did the whole Irish, you know, Shamrocks and the Irish Parade, and it really went over big. And then Amanda and them had like groups like Lords of Brooklyn out of and wanted to do the Italian thing. You know, the poster was like John Travolta and Saturday Night Fever, and you know, the whole thing played up. Pizza boxes was, you know, so. You know, they saw it's a selling point, because you can't avoid that. It's like when the Beastie Boys came out, as much legendary hip hop was before the Beastie Boys, you throw three white faces out there, and all of a sudden the Beastie Boys was the hottest selling album in the history of hip hop. Right. You know, it was a good album. It was produced by Rick and Russell, and they were down with Run DMC, but it was the biggest rap album of all time because it's a white face. So that is part of you know, what they want to sell. And also then Vanilla Ice came out. He was the second biggest rap album in history. I think he sold 11 million behind MC Hammer. It's like, so, and think about what was the percentage of white rappers? It was like 1%, you know, and they just happened to be the biggest selling albums of all time. So they know this is a marketable thing in a lot of cases, you know? So
yeah, but I think one of the things that you...
They tried to say, Since it's all about lyricism with me, keep it so they look at the guy as a lyricist, not as the white thing. I mean, I'm not a marketing guy. I just want to rap. So if you see I'm white, I'm white. If you don't think, I don't care. Just listen to the music and hear me rap. And that's why I'm here, you know? So that's my whole thing. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I dig that. And one of the things though about kind of marketing the white thing, with the exception of the Beastie Boys, and shout out to MCA, one of the nicest dudes in hip hop I ever met.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, rest in peace. Yo, rest in peace to that brother. Like those dudes, with the exception of them, all those other white rappers that marketed their whiteness first didn't have longevity. Like, you've got longevity. M's got longevity. And part of that is also, you know, as major is the skill, but it's also because you didn't put your whiteness out there first, it felt like. Am I wrong about that, or how do you feel?
You know, I'm not sure anymore. I think all the struggles of the industry and just trying to kick it up a notch every year, and skill level, and working on skill, and working harder than I would have if I had success from the front. I think just the hard work ethic, and I'm not sure what it is. Just three decades of touring the world, three decades of selling out shows, three decades of keeping a fan base. You know, it's not like a pop fan base, like a Drake level, but it's like literally three decades of being able to play shows all over the country, all over the world. Like, I could do one in Poland, I could do one in Russia, I'm supposed to do Chile January 15th. But they don't know yet with the new COVID strain. You know, that's up in the air right now. It's only like 16 days away, but they're not sure if that's happening. I mean, I tour the whole planet. And before COVID, I was doing 150 shows a year, you know, and a lot of sold out shows all over the globe. So that's all for doing independent music and keeping it consistent and touring and growing a fan base. You know, I did a lot of it independently. When I was with the major labels, you relied on the major labels. And that's when when it was tough, you know. Once I left that and did it all independently, that everything fell into place, you know. So
yeah, I can say this, because you know, I never liked, I say I'm semi-retired as an MC, but you know, I was signed to Caroline Imperial with Neil Levine back in the day. And anybody who can make a living for 30 years off of that, because I couldn't make a living for one, you know what I mean? Like it was a struggle. I always had to have a job, even when, you know, I was like, oh, we signed a deal, we're doing this, we're on the radio, you know, we got a song on the radio in this city, in that city. And, you know, we're doing shows. I couldn't survive off of $300, $500 shows. You know what I'm saying? And you made a living off of it.
Where are you from?
I'm from Maryland.
Oh, wow. All right.
DC area. DC, Baltimore area.
DC. Shout out to the Bad Brains. You know who they are?
Yeah, of course. Yeah,
they was from DC. My man, Daryl Jennifer, he lives in Woodstock now for the last couple decades. But they were legendary in the hardcore scene.
Yeah. So, you know, Fugazi, also DC guys. Yeah. With
the whole go-go movement, right? Like doing the butt and all of that. Wasn't that all DC?
Go-go. Yeah. EU. Shout out to Sugar Bear.
Yep, Sugar Bear from school. Yeah.
More with RA the Rugged Man in a moment. But in the meantime, we want to remind you that this podcast is brought to you by Gold Co.
Why buy gold? Are you watching what's happening in the world today? The global pandemic, the U.S. debt piling up, spiking inflation, and the looming Biden tax plan. In the 2008 financial crisis, many Americans lost huge amounts of their retirement savings. So what are you doing now to protect your money? Well, many turn to Gold Co. It's the leading precious metals company in the United States and a five-time Inc. 500 winner. With an A-plus rating from the Better Business Bureau, and thousands of positive customer reviews, you can trust the team at Gold Co. to help protect and grow your wealth. Go to goldco.com/save the nation to request your free IRA guide that will share secrets with you that financial advisors don't tell you about. So what are you waiting for? Don't delay and fall victim to another stock market crash, inflation hike, or dollar decline. Visit goldco.com/save the nation and get your free IRA guide today. If you visit goldco.com/save the nation right now, Gold Co. will give you up to $10,000 or more of free silver when you open a qualifying account. That's right, up to $10,000 in free silver. We thank Gold Co. for sponsoring this podcast. Now, back to the show.
So let's talk a little politics. You know what I mean? I know that's what Vince has been waiting for. And of course, we probably got to go right to some of the controversial stuff that's been happening lately. You know what I mean? I'm sure you knew that question was coming. How did that interview with Tim Pool actually happen?
Well, I'm friends with Luke Radowski. He was he came from an era of, like, you know, running up on war criminals, you know, and he'd run up on them and hey, you're a war criminal, and this guy's cool. So we became cool, and I did Anarchy Poco or whatever. It's like, do you know that event? It's like Anarchy in Acapulco in Mexico.
Okay. And,
yeah, I did that event. He got me over there, and you know, he came out in New York. I had Lindsay Snell, who's like a great, great journalist that was like kidnapped by Al-Qaeda and locked up in a Turkish prison, and she just has a hell of a story. So I connected them, and we had dinner together a few times, stuff like that. So when Luke was out in Berlin, he interviewed me. So he asked me in my inbox, he said, come to Tim Pool. And I wasn't really up on Tim Pool, but I'd seen him around. I seen like one kind of bootlickerish video he did. But like, I saw Tim with Luke, I figured, oh, these guys are, you know. And then when they flew me to Maryland, the girl who produces the show, she said, hey, watch his show from 10 a.m. or this and that. So I was in my hotel and I started watching one. And then I saw one where it was like critical race theory is terrible. And this, and I started seeing all this anti-Black stuff and like, oh, Derek Chauvin. So I'm like, what the hell is this guy? So I went there and they treated me really beautifully, really nice. And I'm like, okay, let's see what up. But I said, I have to bring up, you know, this, the anti-black stuff that I hear on the show because I'm here, you know? Right. So there are things I agree with him on, you know, I'm not a fan of the Democrats. I believe, you know, I'm not a big fan of big tech censoring, you know, opponents and all of this stuff. I agree with that stuff. But there was too many instances where it was like, the black guy's bad. The black guy did bad. And you know, here, look on my feet. Kwanzaa is bad. Pro-black is bad. Black power is bad. Everything black is bad for his fan base. So
right.
I just wanted to address it. And I did, you know? So that's how that all came up.
Mm-hmm. So when you, like the critical race theory stuff, I can't address every single one of those things because I don't actually know the context for each of them. But I'll just take critical race theory as an example. You know, there's a bunch of parents who are concerned about critical race theory in schools of like all backgrounds, black, including black parents.
When there's no evidence that it's actually being taught in schools.
Well, this is a pedagogical question. It's basically that you take the principles of critical race theory and they're applied in academics at all levels, rather than teaching critical race theory in schools, right? That's not the issue.
Fourth grade teacher with just a college education knows critical race theory because she studied at law school or in graduate school.
No,
that's where they teach critical race.
Okay, that's a fair critique. Let me stretch it out. What I'm talking about is kind of the race essentialism that's being referred to as a catch-all as critical race theory. Is that fair?
Okay, fine.
Okay, so what I mean by that is like in telling kids that their destiny is determined by their race. And so there's a lot of parents who are very concerned about that and the way that those conversations take place inside of the classroom and certainly with the teachers. So they've been raising their voices about it. I don't think that's particularly anti-black. I think it's pro-human to be concerned about those things.
Why weren't they concerned 6 months ago or 2 years ago? They've been told it's part of a fear-mongering campaign to gain points. And right now, the anti-black movement is very strong. You know, it's like, so why all of a sudden, oh, critical race? Because they're watching all these videos. They're watching Fox News that's telling, oh, this is the devil. Look, they're telling you you're evil, 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 evil. Critical race theory, evil, evil. So, that's all it is. It's another smear campaign that they're consumed by because they keep being told this is going to get your kids. It's going to make your kids hate themselves. No kids going home hating themselves. It, you know, it's all part of the fear scam. So, you know, and everybody watching this from that angle, they go, no, you're wrong. They told a white person he was evil. Who? They find one bad person. It's the same thing they do with riots. It's the same thing they do with anything. They find the one bad person that did one thing or one teacher that said something stupid, and they'll say that's the whole thing of critical race theory. It's propaganda, and it's pick and choose sensationalism clips to scare people. And look, there's one guy, what state is it, where he's trying to ban like 150 books?
Mm-hmm.
Like
800.
Banned. It's 800 books?
It's 850.
Books. And all these free speech right-wingers, oh, we're freedom of speech. They're not complaining about that. They're told, oh, Dr. Seuss. They tried to ban Dr. Seuss. but what about the 800 books that they're trying to ban? That's LGBT, and pro-black books. Well, not even pro-black, just historical books. They're trying to ban these books in schools, and none of the right-wingers complain about it. They don't care, because if they're banning something that they're not into, they're all for it. But then they complain about, oh, ban, cancel culture. You know, it's a fake fraud, you know?
Well, I agree with you. There's definitely some of that for sure. And that, I honestly think that's a bipartisan issue. It's like your standards change the moment it works to your advantage.
I agree.
I definitely concede that point. I just think that there's a danger here in being too reductive. It's like, so if one, kind of like you mentioned that a lot of this gets brought up in a political season. Things that are political are not all inherently bad, right? Politics is the way we redress grievances in a society. We kind of handle the things that we debate. So of course you're going to point to problems and say, hey, there should be a political solution to this. So you're right. Sometimes the volume is going to turn up on various problems in society ahead of an election. The question then becomes like, is it real or is it being trumped up? Is it fake? And that's a perfectly good question. But like, for instance, like, you know, call it like, I don't know if you use the word, but like pointing to like the riots that we've seen in the United States, you know, there were actually a lot of people's lives that were affected by it. And typically they were the people who lived in the most vulnerable communities in our country, the kinds of places that mostly get ignored by the media. There were actually billions of dollars of insurance claims that were made in these cities for the damage that was done there. And more importantly, there were dozens of lives actually lost, including and especially Black lives that were lost during the riots last year. So, I mean, it's not like that was a fiction. That was definitely going on. Now, you can assess if, as you do, is it getting too much attention? Is it being overhyped? But it did seem like it was a real phenomenon. You don't have to turn to Fox News to have determined that, don't you think?
To determine what?
That there were definitely riots going on and there was destruction, and it wasn't just like an occasional isolated incident.
Well, there was a lot of good people in the streets. I know they're not going to say that, but there was a lot of good people in the streets that were fighting against police brutality. And it worked because Derek Chauvin guilty. They're starting to come through. What's the police woman that just shot the boy? Guilty. You know, a year years ago, they wouldn't have been guilty. They wouldn't even probably went to trial. Would have been like, whatever, you know, throw it under the rug. They weren't convicting cops of that stuff like that. So the people coming and coming out in bunches and saying, hey, you know, we had enough, because I mean, they've been killing people in the streets forever. Right. So when does it stop? So a movement had to occur. So the movement began, and it's beginning to work. So yeah, you know, I don't want to have, you know, I have empathy for all lost lives, of course. But as far as the movement, you have to look at the positive as well, you know. So
can I also interject that some of the more violent. And first of all, I think there should be a distinction between violence and destruction of property. Those are not the same thing. I had a lot of my friends go to jail for graffiti. You know, that's not, you could argue that it's destruction of property, but it's not violence. So I think that people a lot of times conflate those two when it's come to some of the things that we've seen. Now, again, you know, a lot of the, or some of the destruction that we've seen in those uprisings was, you know, and it's been proven, some of it was provocateurs, like the Boogaloo Boys and other people going through breaking windows and trying to get things hyped up. Even Max, what's the guy from the Gray Zone? Max
Rosenblum or something?
Yeah. I know him. He used to rap. He used to rap in DC. Anyway, point being, Max Blumenthal, that's his name, Max Blumenthal.
Yeah.
Even he followed some dudes who were all dressed in black, and it turns out, you know, they got into like an unmarked car. It was like crazy. So, you know, let's not leave off the table that some of this could have been done by provocateurs. The other thing that I would say is, I don't know if y'all remember this, but do you remember that when the media hyped up this idea of the knockout game?
Yeah, of course. They always
that,
do.
Yeah. Look, that black teenagers all over the country. Thing.
Look, yeah. Look at all these terrible black people, and then all these racist white people put up the clips like, look at these animals. Look, and then they get they have the right to call black people savages. Look at these savages. Look at these awful black people. And you go to their page, and it's all, every retweet is like a black person doing something terrible. But then they worship Kyle Rittenhouse. You know, it's like.
And the thing was, you found out the knockout game wasn't real. Yep. Like, it wasn't a thing. They were making it seem like it was this nationwide phenomenon of black people looking for unsuspecting white people to be walking around and just punch them in the face and see if they could knock them out.
That's what they've been doing since the beginning of history, is villainize the black man, the black man, scary black man, rapist black man, terrible black man, murderer, hoodlum black man. That's what they've been doing since the beginning of America's existence, you know, and they continue. But right. Now we got the digital world, you know, let's put it on Twitter. You know, it's the same thing, just different devils.
Right. Right.
You know, I do think I agree with you on a general principle that the media is this massive distortion filter in through which reality doesn't flow. And, you know, like there was the case, what was the name of the girl who ended up murdered, or the guy killed himself to laundry and get, I forget what her name was.
That was right next to my cousin's house in Long Island. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So you've got, I'm talking about Brian Laundrie down in Florida. I don't know if this is the same case.
I don't know. The family's from Long Island.
Oh, are they?
Yeah, yeah. They both went to school in Long Island, and the case happened. And
yeah, Gabby Petito, that was the name of the girl. So
Holbrook, I think.
So that story goes down, and then there's all this criticism in some of the basically the more liberal news outlets who come out and they say, well, how come we're focused on Gabby Petito, but we never focus on all of these, you know, non-white people who get kidnapped or disappear? We don't spend any time on that subject. And that's like a useful form of media criticism, except the people who are saying it, they've got these platforms and they don't do that. They never do that. They don't spend any time on those issues. And then they come out and they're like, you know, what's a real problem is that we're never covering these non-white people when they go missing. The whole thing is like a sham. It's like, what are you talking about? You've got the platform to do it. How come you're not doing it?
No,
I agree. I agree with you 100%. Yeah. Like I saw some of the clips, like acting like her death didn't mean anything because, you know, Gabby, how you say her name? Petito. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was horrendous and it was horrible. And it was a story. The man was on the run. It was a story that people wanted to hear about and they wanted to see justice served. And it wasn't, obviously. And then, you know, throw back into sensationalism with the celebrity thing. They had the who's the bounty hunter guy? Oh, I'm going to get him.
Dog.
Too.
Yeah.
Bad in there. So it was a story the public wanted to hear about. So to say, oh, this isn't so important. It was kind of a little disrespectful to the girl. The thing that was crazy to me, though, which people get mad at me, I'm sure, because I never said this publicly, but the way they attacked the murderer's parents, like they were the worst people that ever lived. And I was kind of like, you know, their son did the worst act of all time. He's done. His life is over. They're crushed. They're mourning. They know he's, you know, so you're not going to act rational. You're panicking. You're losing your mind. I mean, I don't think people have empathy for a whole situation. They just look, these are the bad guys. These are the good guys.
Yep.
Yeah. In that situation, I seen the way they were going after his parents. Arrest his parents. His parents are the worst. And I was kind of like, it's a poor couple who knows their son did this horrible act. And they lost their son. They know he's done. If it's not jail for life, he's going to kill himself So I think the way they were, you know, who cares, man? The world is just crazy.
Yeah.
Everything turns into the Frankenstein with the torches chasing it down. These are always think that they're good people. Let's hunt them down with torches.
Right.
Into that, you know? So
let me just say, like with the Gabby Petito situation, I don't know if this happened, to be honest, but I'll just say, like, anybody who was upset with Gabby Petito or her family trying to gather as much information from the public and get as much coverage from the public in order to find their daughter is an idiot and certainly isn't a parent. You know what I mean? Like, anybody would want to do that.
Hell yeah.
And the three of us have daughters. You know what I mean? I got two. One of them screaming, you know, in the room next door. You know,
man, if my daughter went missing, I'd call both of you up. I don't even know RA. I'd be like, all right, I had a conversation with you once, but if you know anybody who can help me, I would pull.
Definitely.
I would
be like, yo, all right, let me come on your Twitter. Let me, you know, retweet me. You know what I mean? Of course, for my daughters or my son. But let me just say, the thing is, that might happen for your daughters. It doesn't happen for people who look like my daughters. And that's the issue. That is a real issue. So let me just do this. We're all somehow kind of close in age. So let me ask you this. How many of you have heard the name Elizabeth Smart? Mm-hmm. You know Elizabeth Smart, right? Mm-hmm. You know Chandra Levy. You know JonBenet Ramsey. You know Amanda Berry. These are names you know, right? Can you name one Black girl who went missing that became national news? You know, what was the one that went to Aruba? What was her name?
Natalie Holloway.
Natalie Holloway. Natalie Holloway was the biggest story of 2005.
Right.
You know what else happened in 2005? Hurricane Katrina. Mm-hmm. And Natalie Holloway was the number one story.
Mm-hmm.
So thousands of mostly Black people losing their homes, losing their lives. Some of those bodies are still in those buildings. And her going missing was bigger news than that. It got more coverage.
Wow.
And so, you know, JonBenet Ramsey, I saw something about JonBenet Ramsey the other day on TV. And it had to be, she'd be like 35 now.
Right.
So the thing is,
it's true.
40% of, you know, one of my friends does a lot of stuff on human trafficking. 40% of the people that are human trafficked in this country. As a matter of fact, one of the names for human trafficking was white slavery. 40% are Black women. And so for me, yes, that's an issue. I, you know, the Black press does follow it, by the way. You know, like Jet Magazine used to do stuff on missing Black people.
Mm-hmm.
And with all of that, it is frustrating. Of course, I would do anything. You know, I'm getting to know R.A. I feel like we're homies now. Vince, you're my man. We disagree on lots of stuff, but you're my brother. Like, I would do anything if something happened and you needed my help with your daughters. My thing is, the press would follow that. The press doesn't follow my daughters. Amanda Berry, if you remember that thing in Cleveland, there were two other girls there, two or three. And we all know Amanda Berry's name. You know why we don't know the other girls? Because they were Puerto Rican. Don't even know their names. It was Puerto Rican girls in there because the guy who got them was Ariel Castro. Mm-hmm. And he had them, but everybody knew Amanda Berry. When the dude with the funny hair, the Black dude, kicked in the door, he was like, you know, Amanda Berry, because we heard her name all over the city. But you never heard about those Puerto Rican girls who were in there for years, giving birth to the guy's kids.
True.
So I understand where y'all are coming from, and it's not Gabby Petito's fault. And of course, it's not Natalie Holloway's fault. I think there's a class element to that too, because I don't know who gets to go on their senior trip to Aruba. You know, I went to a really nice school and we didn't go to Aruba for senior. We went to Ocean City, Maryland. You know what I mean? But I think there's probably a class element and the people they had access to.
Yeah.
But that became a huge story. You know, when it's a white girl, and even you said it when we talked about it, Vince, you were like, well, Gabby Petito is a cute white girl. You remember when we had that conversation?
Yeah, I'm just thinking, actually, as you're talking now, I'm thinking it's also like pretty privileged too. It's like, right, it's like, but the media
Black girls don't get to be pretty.
The media will take a picture of, you know, an attractive kidnapped victim and put it on screen, and then they think that'll get you to unmute your TV. That, like, you know, maybe.
So no Black girls are pretty enough. That's
ask a TV producer. Ask these guys who are throwing it together. Yeah,
shouldn't be about prettiness. But even if it is, we don't see any Black girls that fit that description. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
It's, you know, as a Black man, a Black father who has Black daughters and a Black son, like, you know, for me, I look at it like I want every, and this is the thing. Everybody thinks this is what these white supremacist guys that pretend to be left wing on the internet, they make it seem like, oh, these Black people, they want to bring you down. No, I want to bring myself up so I get the same access to stuff that you get. You know what I mean? That was the whole idea. It's not about trying to bring Gabby Petito down and take her off the TV. It's like, hey, why don't we have Shakisha Jackson, I'm just making up a name, or Felicia Barnes, who was somebody in Baltimore who got a little bit of press, you know, and that went through several states, but it wasn't nationwide news. It was local. You know, why don't we talk about Natalie Holloway and Felicia Barnes the same amount?
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'm asking for. I want to find, if I could find Natalie Holloway, she's probably not around anymore, but I don't think they ever found her.
You also know it's a ratings game they play, and you know what's going to bring it. You know, like I said, the sensationalism and the celebrity attached to it, and everybody came to the, you know, and they had the videotape of the cops, and they made a big thing out of it. I'm not too familiar with it. That, you know, I know the basics of it, so I don't want to go too deep into it. But you're totally right about that. Do you guys remember a weird case from my childhood where, like, a boy was kidnapped and it was national news everywhere? And then a couple decades later, they said that he was in Bush's cat. There's a conspiracy theory that he was like a gay guy, a gay prostitute in Bush 2's cabinet. You know who I'm talking about? Johnny. You guys don't remember?
Yo, I never heard that one.
Look it up, man. It's a boy, Johnny something, and he got kidnapped. And it was a it was national news all over. And then 15 years later, he said he was a child slave, and then there was a gay guy in the Bush 2's cabinet. And they said he was a gay prostitute, and they said that's him. You know, that was the big conspiracy theory. You know, so I don't know much about it. It's the fun look up. Yeah. Should I go shut off my phone? Keeps beeping.
We can't hear it. It's all right.
Yeah, I haven't heard it.
It's all right. So what motivates you politically? All right. I mean, you know, obviously you've been doing some political podcasts here. It's an issue that's important to you. You know, what's the thing that motivates you about politics?
Well, you know, my family, where I come from, my father was a highly decorated soldier in the Vietnam War. He was a Green Beret in the Army. He was a Screaming Eagle in the Air Force, 101 Infantry. He got shot down, and my family was affected by that because, you know, they put him into all these secret missions where Agent Orange was sprayed. So I've told this story many times, but it's a true story. So then my brother, he was born, he couldn't walk or talk, and he was blind. My sister, she couldn't walk or talk and see. My nephew, he lived 6 months and his body just collapsed. So I was raised by my father, and at 10 years old, he had me in the kill them all, let God, you know, sort them out. You know, I was the gung-ho guns, you know, he had me shooting 22s in the garage, 4 or 5 years old. So I came from that. And then as time went on, I started realizing like, wow, like my father, 17-year-old kid, they put him in this war.
Yeah.
They trained him to be a killer. And then you look into the Vietnam War, and then you look into every war since.
Right.
And you go, what was the purpose of any of it for real? Yeah.
And those guys got, of course, crapped on when they came back too.
Of course.
Just to add insult to injury.
Of course. But even then, it's like, not even just my family. If you look at the children in Vietnam and like all of the people born disfigured with no eye sockets and no limbs and women having like miscarriages and their baby's body parts falling apart when they come, like Agent Orange really destroyed so many lives. And Monsanto is this company and Bayer just bought them out for like $1.3 billion. And you get some people that try to defend them, go, it's not the same. It's the same, you know, it's the same thing. They just know they have to reinvent themselves. But it's like, so I slowly started looking into that and coming from, like I said, a military background, a military father, you start thinking, oh, guns and blazing and this and that. And then you start going like, wait, people are really actually dying. Mm-hmm. And I have a little cousin who's raised by his military father. And I heard him talk and he was like, well, if they mess with America, we'll just kill them. And I was like, little boy, listen, how would you feel if we're sitting at the dinner table right now with your mom, your dad, and a missile comes through the house and blows up your family and you're left there with no family? That's what's happening. That's what the USA is doing to other countries and other children and other families. And right now, you think you're young, you think it's cool, kill them all. Because I was 10 years old with the same, kill them all, let God sort them out. Mm-hmm. And that's brainwashing. That's the same thing that we complain, oh, look what the Al-Qaeda is doing to their children. Their children have guns and they want to kill us. It's like the same thing that we do to our children with this pro-America, pro-military, kill. And you know, so that's a big part of what got me into a bit of politics, yes.
So, is there like, and I know like you said, you don't like Democrats, you don't like Republicans. Is there a candidate that kind of represents a little bit of your interests or your politics that you could see yourself supporting?
At this moment, I can't see one. You know, like you know, we need a new batch of people. The people they're throwing at us from both sides. It's just, you know, so I don't see anybody at the moment that I'm into. No, so I mean, you, if you get the anti-war rhetoric of like of a young Ron Paul, you know, when he was, you know, hey, get, let's get out of all the countries, let's not go to war. That was decent of him, you know. But his son is, you know, Rand.
Yeah.
He's not his father, you know. Right. And then you have Tulsi Gabbard, who had this whole anti-war rhetoric. Her whole thing was like anti-war and you know, look, Kamala locked up all these black folks and Kamala, you know, and then as soon as the election ended, she started turning into pro-war again and blah, blah. And it's like, you know, so these people, who could we even trust in this day and age, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like, right. If you go to other European countries too, though, if you go to European countries like Germany, where I'm in, there's 5, 6, 7, 8 parties. And but we're brainwashed in America where we believe that only these two parties. So we're stuck with Biden and Trump and Trump and Hillary. And the next election, who are we going to get? Biden or Kamala versus what? It's like Trump again, maybe. It's like we have our country is, it's almost like the fall of the Roman Empire. Do we have any hope? Is there any America left? It's like, we really have like, Angela Merkel, I'm not a big fan of her politics, but when she spoke in Germany, it was like an intelligent human being having a conversation. And you know, that's not Trump, that's not Biden. We have idiots, you know? And like, even go to Putin, who obviously his politics are terrible on so many levels, and he's not a good man. But like, take Joe Biden and then Putin, and they have the press there. Putin, hey, American press, whoever wants to ask me something, ask me something. He'll just talk to you because he's smart enough to have a conversation and not be scripted. Hey, ask me something. American press, as soon as Joe Biden gets up there, we must protect him and only give him the press that we know, the, you know, who the guy is and what's what. And like, why are you scared to answer questions? You know, because they're not smart enough. Our leaders, our leaders, you know, if they lead us even, aren't smart enough to even have conversations. I mean, you seen the let's go Brandon thing. Like, come on, are you that out of touch? You get on TV, go, yeah, let's go Brandon, I agree. You know, like, you know, you're that out of touch, Joe Biden, where you don't even know what that means. You know, it's like, come on, guys.
I think he knew what it meant. I think he was trying to like,
oh, you do?
Yeah, I think he did. I don't think he.
You know, it's funny.
He was trying to be like, yeah, because what was he gonna be like? Yeah, fuck you too. You know, be like.
You know,
yeah.
I've been relitigating. I don't know about you guys, but I've been relitigating that moment. Like, God, if I was Biden, I wouldn't have said that. Like, that yeah, just like, makes
I agree.
You.
He said, "I agree." He goes, "I agree."
Like, if you wanna take the air out of it, just like attack it as like an immoral affront. Like, hey, whoa, we just had a nice conversation. I don't know why you would say something like that. But Merry Christmas to you. I hope your family is well. And then you move on to somebody else. I mean, he didn't look like he had his footing. Like he was like, aha, I agree.
I think he got caught off guard.
His wife was cringing sitting next to him.
Yeah. I think he got caught off guard. Like he wasn't expecting that. Like you didn't screen this guy. Like,
yeah.
You know, so I honestly, there's a lot of stuff that Joe Biden has said in the last year that I was like, man,
see, you know, this is the problem too, though. If you look at Joe Biden's history, there's so much racism, there's segregation, there's
for sure.
all these quotes, there's the crime bill. But then what do? Then you lean right, and then you have all these hate-mongering racist right-wingers too. It's like, so what, you know, like the Democrat Party so corrupt and so much lies and so much fraud, but then where do you go? Who do you go to? The right wing? These right wing maniacs? No. So you don't go to Biden. So what do? And then when you go, I won't go for either one of them. Then everybody hates you and they call you. You know, look at how they treat Susan Sarandon. You know, Susan Sarandon, like the worst person ever lived to these people because she doesn't like Trump. She doesn't like Hillary. She doesn't like Biden. She doesn't like any of them. But they don't talk about the good that somebody like Susan Sarandon has been doing for 30, 40 years in the community. Right. And they all love AOC. And who got AOC elected? Susan Sarandon. But they won't bring up that. They'll blame her for getting Trump elected. You know, it's like,
I mean, I think honestly, like, and I do think that there are some politicians, you know, progressive politicians who are still good. You know, we interview Ro Khanna. There's a couple of others, you know, Mondaire Jones, what's his name? You know, dang it, I'm forgetting his name. Cori Bush, all of those people. I think that there are still some politicians who have values. You know, you may not agree with the language that they use. I know people got really mad at Cori Bush for saying birthing people instead of mothers or whatever it is. But when you look at her principles and the fact that she was, for example, a woman who was on food stamps and has been homeless and is a mother, you know what I mean? And brought herself out of that and is trying to help other people in those situations. I think there are still some politicians that are okay. Largely, I agree with you. You know what I mean? And Biden, we can't deny.
There's somebody out there in politics that wants to do good for people. I'm sure they're out there. I'm not educated on it enough to know one at this point in my right. life. I look around, I listen to some speeches here and there, I listen to the talk, I look at some tweets, and I'm like, yo, everybody's trash right now. Everybody. So and I'm sure that there's got to be a good person out there. But when there is a good person, how much power do they give that good person? They don't give them no power, you know? It's like
and they get wrecked, they get put through the wood chipper. So I mean, if you're like a father who's trying to raise his family and you're like, I've got some ideas for like, you know, how to help society. I'm looking around. This would help my family. This would help other families. A lot of those people are like, you know what? It's not worth it. I can't jump into this because it's going to wreck my life. It's going to wreck my kids' lives. And so I think good people get scared off of it from I think a disgusting industry.
Yeah.
I mean, I think Susan Sarandon should run for office.
I love her. I love Susan Sarandon.
You know, and
yo, if she ran, that would be my politician right there. I vote Susan Sarandon.
I mean, the other, what was the I other woman who ran against Cuomo? The redhead from Sex actress? And the City.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm forgetting her name.
But look in New York, even like look when they had the new mayor. It's like who did the right get to run against them? The guardian angel, Curtis Sliwa.
Sliwa, yeah.
And it's like, guys, we can't. And that now, so we have like an ex cop that wants to bring back Stop and Frisk, and he's the Democrat. So where do we run to? Where do we run to? You know what I mean? Kamala Harris. How many people has she got put in jail? And she's the Democrat. So you know. Right. Who do we go to?
So what would be your answer? Because I was actually reading an article about this earlier. I know, you know, you're from Long Island, but like, I know you spent a lot of time in the city.
Wait. You brought up Long Island real quick before we went on. Suffolk mm-hmm. County. Bring them up again. Bring them up real quick. I know.
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely. You know, Suffolk County. We got to give a shout out to my man, K Solo. You know,
I said Suffolk County. He said the cops of Suffolk County. I'm known as
a fugitive.
Yeah. K Solo's a dear friend and a great one of the most slept on storytellers in hip hop. Right. I'm sorry for getting off topic, but I just wanted to throw a little K Solo.
No doubt. Shout out to the incredible Letterman, K Solo.
You know, he got hands too. You know, he got hands. Solo's a boxer.
Oh, for real? Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yep, he got hands.
Right. Yo, are him? So there was always, I know Hurricane G and Redman are related. Is K Solo related to them, or are they just light skin?
I mean, you know what? I know Redman for almost three decades. I know Eric since I'm a kid. I know Eric since I'm probably 14, 15. And he was already, you know, EPMD. He was like a superhero to me.
Yeah.
And I never heard that Redman and Hurricane G were related. I never heard that. I heard a rumor that Eric had Hurricane G's baby or stuff like this. I don't know the whole gossip stuff, you know? So, but K Solo is definitely not related to any of them, though.
Oh, okay. Word. Yeah, I'll just say this. If you want to talk hip hop, one of the tests that I give you, whether I give you any credibility, is like, how do you feel about EPMD? If you don't like EPMD, I don't even want to talk hip hop with you. If you're not an EPMD fan, you know, obviously everybody likes Tribe Called Quest, you know, and stuff like that. If your knowledge starts with like Outkast, then I'm, you know.
I love Tribe, but EPMD greater than, you know, EPMD goes.
That's a tough one. You know, we have to talk about that on another podcast.
My boy too, Q-Tip. I know Q-Tip since I'm 18. Like I love Q-Tip, and he's made some of the greatest music ever. But I'm a Suffolk County guy. EPMD, when they exploded on the scene, it was like one of our high, like, you know.
It was
tell me your names again, man. I'm sorry.
Jason.
I'm Vince.
Yo, Vince, I'm sorry. When we start talking boxing and rap, you just sit there.
I like listening to it. I mean, I'm not, it reminds me of being like a kid sitting at the dinner table listening to the adults speak. I was like, you know, I just listen. I'm fine. I'm going to soak.
Like, can we just go back to how evil Kwanzaa is?
No, it's great. Actually, listening to this makes me want to check out like a lot of stuff that I haven't been exposed to. So, it's
good. Where are you from, Vince?
I'm from all over the place. I'm a military brat. My dad's was a lifelong Marine. He just got out a couple years ago. He did 36 years in the Marine Corps. I come from a military family, so I've got tons of uncles who all served. I've got my brother served. My dad was deployed a bunch of times to Iraq, Afghanistan. He was in the Gulf War. My brother was deployed to Afghanistan. He blew up in Helmand Province driving a route clearance vehicle.
He died?
He didn't die. He's all right. No, he got a concussion. He got a traumatic brain injury from it.
And it's still, forever, right?
Yeah, that's what they say. He's got the effects of it, but he's good. He seems living a really healthy life. He's good. He's living outside Philly now. He's got a bunch of kids. He does HVAC work.
So the average person couldn't even tell though, right? He's
no,
good.
No, no. Yeah. He's good. No, that's the, yeah. Thank you for asking. No, he's good. But the point is, that was the life experience I came from. I kind of grew up in military housing, living all over the country. And then ended up in DC as my dad kind of ended his career here. I started my career here and, I've been here ever since.
Wow. DC. Do you ever go to, what's the pizza place? The famous pizza place from Pizzagate.
Comet Pizza. You know, I haven't actually been to Comet Pizza. Have you been there, Jason?
No, I've never been there.
Comet.
I pass by it all the time. I've never actually ate the pizza.
Yeah, I passed by there. That's it.
Yeah, nah, it's crazy.
When I did that Tim Pool thing, I thought it was because they flew me to DC. I thought it was at DC, so I was like, yeah, I should go check out Comet Pizza and see. but I didn't realize that they drive you to Maryland and stuff. You
know? Yeah, he lives out in like Frederick County, like right like that.
It was kind of bugged out. They like drive you to the, like this, you know, get out of DC. They have a driver take you to this big fence and then, okay, you know, and then.
Yeah, I mean, he makes millions, from what I hear, he makes millions and millions of dollars on that YouTube stuff.
Wow.
We need to find out his
secret. Where's our action?
Straight up. But people, that's the thing though, that RA is saying is like, it's unfortunate, but people don't want to hear both sides of an issue. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think there's a lot of people in the audience of the Daily Caller who are upset that I'm here. You know what I mean? Like, they don't like hearing. And there's a lot of those, you know, crossover people who, you know, I think the internet skews a particular way. And one of the things I will say, you know, I saw your interview, RA, with where you were on Young Turks recently.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'll go on your show. I'll go on the Turks. I'll go on Gutfeld. I'll go on Talib Kweli's podcast.
Yeah.
Call me. I'll look you. Okay, cool. Let's do it. I'm not afraid to get with, you know, this is what we're here for. We live life short. If somebody wants to hear your voice, put your voice out there. So I it's the point I made on the Young Turks. I said, if you look back at old Dick Cavett, interviews on the Dick Cavett show. This was before my time, but they're all on YouTube. He had all these like different point of views from like segregationists to like pro-Black Panther to like whoever. And they all sat in the same room and had conversations. And at this point, it's like, how dare you go on the Young Turks? How dare you go on this? Don't go on it. No. If the outlet is open and is interested in my voice, I'm going on the outlet. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, we try to do that here, but I don't, you know, it's hard to find the audience for that. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, because everybody wants the, you know, they want,
yeah,
they want to hear what they want to hear. They don't want to hear the conflicting side of what they want to hear, you know?
So, yeah, people want comfort food.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I personally, I like hearing all sides at once. You know what I mean? Not like an echo chamber. Like I can't watch like for example, like Candace Owens. You know what I mean? I can't just watch her, but I can watch her and Mark Lamont Hill have a conversation. Like I enjoy that. You know what I'm saying? Like I like having both sides.
Mark Lamont Hill is one of the leaders in debating of critical race theory. Like, right. You know, I don't agree with everything Mark Lamont Hill has to say either, but I agree with a lot of it, you know? Yeah. And the one thing I agree with him on is critical race theory. And if you debate him on critical race theory, he'll stomp you out. That's who he is. He's got everything, you know, he's just super highly educated on critical race theory and he'll body you. And all the main anti-critical race theory guys, they go on his show and he bodies all of them. You can't, yeah. You won't find one debate with Mark Lamont Hill debating critical race theory that he loses. He bodies all the leading, it's the most evil thing of all time. He bodies every one of them.
And he never gets angry either. He's always polite.
Yeah, like I can't say the same, you know, but yeah, Mark is a cool, you know, he's got his thing together.
The thing that I liked in the interview with you and I always call him Jank, whatever.
They said I was saying his name wrong too.
Yeah, I think it's, I don't know. But at any rate, that guy, like one of the things that tripped me out was because I always, you know, I used to look at like all of that stuff on the internet. I would look at Turks. I would look at Jimmy Dore, you know, Kyle Kalinske, all of those like kind of people that I thought were left wing on the, you know, on the internet. And now they all got beef, right? So
yeah, I tried to make peace.
I saw that. And the one thing I got to say, and anybody who knows me knows that I'm all like about like peace and love and leading with empathy and trying to understand everybody. But I kind of liked when Jake was like, nah, fuck peace. It ain't never going to be peace. Like he sounded like a fat Turkish Tupac. He was like... It's all for life. Like he got hype at the end. Yes,
I said, hey, I think maybe let's all have peace. You and Jimmy Dore, crazy.
It was hilarious.
Everywhere RA goes, he has to stir up the pot, man.
By calling for peace.
but apparently they all did hurtful things to each other. I don't know. But Jimmy, I met Jimmy briefly at the Young Turks back when Jill Stein was running. And I started looking at his videos ever since. And I agree with a lot of stuff Jimmy has to say on a lot of issues. And then I do understand where they're coming from on a couple of the points. Like they said, you know, he gets that whole kind of Tim Pool audience with the pro Kyle Rittenhouse stuff. But there's a lot of things that I do agree with him on. Like I do agree with the whole Russiagate thing that Aaron Matei and Jimmy Dore, I believe that Russiagate was a made up, sensationalized piece of propaganda, you know? And I agree with him on that. And that's a right-wing talking point that I agree with, that Russiagate was an exaggerated 4 years of it telling us over and over, Russiagate, the compromised Russia, fear-mongering Russia, you know, the Red Scare all over again. And I agree with that 100%. And I think the Democrats were disgusting for that. And when I would say that I agreed with it, all the other people would be like, oh, you support Trump. I hate Trump. I dislike Trump. I wish Trump never existed. But I'm going to be honest, as I believe Russiagate was some scam. You know, I think
I'm with you. I, you know, as far as Russiagate, like I understood initially the concern because of some of the things Trump said publicly, but I definitely think I remember
it's fear mongering again. It's the same thing the right does. It's just fear.
But they started pumping it up, and Rachel Maddow did it every night, and it was just like, all right, this is
Rachel was the worst one with it, though. She was the worst one with it.
Like, yeah, it was just like, yo, this is overboard. And then, like, the part that really got me is not Bernstein, Woodward, Bob Woodward. When he said, look, I looked at it, it's not there. You know, he said that early on, and I was like, Bob Woodward is about as good a journalist as you will find. If he couldn't find it, Rachel Maddow sitting behind her desk is not going to find it. You know what I mean?
What was the famous thing that Rachel said? She had one episode that where she was like, and the Russians are going to turn the lights off in your house. It was like the most every year ever. Like, you'll see the clip online. I was like, come on, you know? But that's the same audience. It's like, that's what I'm saying on the Turks as well. It's like people who only want that Lane will only listen to Maddow, you know? And people who want that Tucker will only listen to Tucker and so on and so on. So it's like, and then they all think, oh, you live in a bubble. You listen to corporate media. And the same thing with the YouTube people, the pool people. It's like they only listen to pool. And then they think, oh, you live in a bubble if you don't believe what pool says. It's like, no, you all are in a little bubble, you know, because you only listen to that one side. Listen to everybody. You know, the last thing they say, oh, RA's in a bubble because I believe that, you know, Blacks aren't treated fairly in America. So that they put me, oh, you're in that bubble. And every comment is, you listen to CNN and MSNBC. You're a puppet for CNN and MSNBC. Like, I don't even have cable in Germany with them channels. I don't watch that stuff. I don't look at that stuff. But I listen, I read, I have, you know, I spend time with all different sides of everybody. Like, that's why you'll see me on every show and talk to everybody. I've dinner. If you come out to one of my dinners, I have people of all types, you know, from every political angle out to dinner talking, and we talk and we have conversations. So that's the opposite of a bubble, you know?
Right. Yeah, no, I think we definitely have to think for ourselves. And, you know, obviously, you know, I don't like Trump at all. And I think there are certain things that he's done that are atrocious. And I think, you know, the impeachment for January 6th, I think it was fair. But I think definitely there are also things that it was like overboard. And when you went overboard, I think it pushed people in the middle, you know, that maybe could be persuadable by the left. Like, it pushed them into the right wing category. You know what I mean? So I definitely agree with you
100%, because what happens is once you see them exaggerating and lying, right, then you stop believing the other side. So meanwhile, if Trump was exaggerating and lying about everything, and it was about ego, but they see like, wow, this is supposed to be my source of media telling the truth, and they're lying about certain things and exaggerating certain things about Trump. So then they go, Trump must be the truth teller. It's like, no, they're all liars, you know?
Yeah.
But it feeds the fire, and it gives people an excuse to go run to Trump.
You know? And I'm going to tell you right now, yo, son, I'm guilty of, you know, in a way, talking so much about Trump that,
too,
you know, we could have been talking about those missing Black kids, but instead we spent so much time on Trump. You know what I mean? And CNN still spending time on Trump. It's like, let the committee do what they do. Let January 6th committee do what they do. Keep us somewhat informed, but move on. Talk about some other things that are going on in our society.
That's how he got elected.
Right. And I'm guilty.
He got elected probably because of how much the left talked about him.
Right.
You know, it was like free publicity. Every tweet, it's Trump, 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 Trump. Like, it's the same thing with music. It doesn't matter how terrible a song is. If every single person on the planet is talking about that song, the song's going to have fans.
Yeah.
And the more you talk about the song, even if it's terrible, it's going to grow a fan base. That's anything from music to politics. So if the whole entire planet is talking about this one man over and over all the way, and it's all that people going to go, well, I don't like her, so I must like him. I must like, you know, you're growing that fan base.
Let me just say this real quick to relate it to hip hop. I'll tell you, like, so I'm originally from Harlem, you know, from East Harlem.
What?
And what's that?
What part?
101st between Lexington and Park.
Well, I lived on 145th and Lenox for about 12 years.
Yeah, oh, word. Okay.
I literally just moved 2016 when my daughter was born, but I was in Harlem for 12 years. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm from Spanish Harlem. So all my family, cousins, and everything, when the whole Tupac Biggie thing was going on, you know, everybody was Biggie, Biggie, Biggie. What did that make me? I was like, Tupac. You know what I mean? It just, I just as a reaction, and then I started listening to Tupac. I started listening to more of his interviews. I started, you know, because I think it just initially just pushes you. When yeah. people are trying to batter you with one side, at a certain point, you get, you know, kind of contrarian at a certain point, like, yo, let's consider this other side. Mm-hmm. And then it'll push you further and further and further, you know, to the point where I was almost talking about West Side and I ain't never even been to the West Coast. I've been to California like twice in my entire life. But yeah,
contrarianism is a strange thing because sometimes it's warranted, but what it is we want to so hard not be the follower, not be the puppet, right. not be part of this you know, machine that's being told, telling you what to believe, what to watch, what to think, who to vote for. You want to be you don't want to be part of that, you know. So you start pulling away and going, whoa, well, I'm right there with you. Yeah. You know, I've had some political point of views where, like, I've heard the one side so much where you start saying a stupid side just to get the F away from that side of it, you know? And so I understand what you're talking about with that. And then you back up a little bit and you look at it with a clear mind and you go, no, now you can see clearly, boom, boom, boom. Same right. thing like a hot new album comes out and everybody's talking, oh, the greatest album of all time, the greatest album of all time. And a lot of people are going along with that. Greatest album of all time. And then you're like, it's not that great. I listened to it.
Yeah.
You know, but become 5 years later, you could put that same, the hype is gone. You put the same album on and the same people, oh, the greatest album of all time. They might go, you know what? It wasn't what I thought it was. And the person who didn't love it, that was going contrary to what people believe, might go, nah, I hear some things in that thing. I understand why people thought it was great. You know, distance yourself from the hype, the buzz, and all of the insanity, and you can see things clearly, you know, and you can see for yourself more, you know?
Yeah, no, that, I mean, in politics, you see like a lot of, like people just follow the crowd a lot politically on what their party's saying, and they don't actually take any time to take an inventory of all that. Like the right is famous in terms for that, for screwing that up when it comes to the Iraq war. I mean, like, just like look at the way that sentiment has changed on the Iraq war over the last two decades. And for now sure. everyone's sort of against it now, but like, you know, I was a kid in college and I thought it seemed totally justified to me at the time. And I was willing to forgive any sort of countervailing evidence, you know, that kind of thing. And your opinion changes on all that. I do think that.
But even the sorry.
Go ahead. You want to make a point about that?
What I was going to say, I even remember though, after 9/11, you know, America was so hurt that I even remember Lefty, you know, they hated Bush, but when he made this speech, smoke them out of the holes, or what was the famous mm-hmm. thing they said about smoking them out of the holes? I even remember the left was like, yeah, Bush, he said something, smoke them out, get, you know, everybody wanted revenge for this action.
Yes.
You know, he went to the wrong place for revenge, but, you know, he started a war somewhere, but you know, so I remember, you know, a lot of people was on side, yeah, blow something up, kill right. somebody. We need revenge. We need vengeance. They came on, you know, they killed our people. Kill somebody. I remember that. And it wasn't just from the right at that time. It was not everybody. It was
kind of goes back to how we started. It's like, you know, like you don't want to fight with anger when you're boxing. You got to think clearly. And so like you're being led by emotion, you make bad decisions. And also it lets your leaders make bad decisions on your behalf. So the other part is.
Yeah. And that was what Barbara Lee said too. That was her whole
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, Barbara Lee was the only one who voted against the. Yeah,
she was like, I'm not saying don't do it. Let's just take a second.
You know yeah, take I mean? A breath. I remember I went back, I watched that speech. She was right about that sentiment. Yeah. So then there's what we were talking about a moment ago, just like the reason people buy into stuff. Like it's one thing for like you or I mean, obviously we're in our position in the media, we have some responsibility to like, you know, think through and know the facts and share it when we share them. But if you're just a guy who's like consuming the news, and you're being misled by it or whatever, or you see your friends all buy into this album and you're like, oh, I guess I should like it too since everybody else is liking it. That's going on. But the problem I have is that these newsrooms, as we've talked about throughout this conversation, are being grossly irresponsible with the facts on so many stories. You know, a lot has been said about like, oh, people on Facebook are sharing misinformation. That's not the most damaging stuff. The most damaging stuff is the misinformation that we get from our own media. And it's all over the place. So I'll just pick one example. Because Trump became the filter through which the media made all of his decisions. As you mentioned, it's like, okay, if we're going to talk about Trump all the time. That's what we get the ratings from. Also, if Trump does something, we're going to take a position against it no matter what it is. So like Trump says, you know, there's a chance this thing came from a lab, meaning COVID in China. The media immediately sided against him. That's a racist conspiracy theory. You know, you're not allowed to say that, blah, blah, blah. And it neutered a very real and consequential debate because the press, instead of doing its due diligence, decided it would take a partisan side and went to hyperbole immediately.
Yeah. But we'll never know the answer to that.
Thing with the vax, though, where, you know, when he said, oh, rush these vaxes out, you know, and all of them, all of the left was, oh, I would never take that vax. Trump did. And then as soon as he's gone, they're like, get vax. So which one is it? You know, it's the same exact vax. It's the same exact one. But so yeah, they're blinded by, partisan, you know, politics.
Yeah. I'll say this about the vax thing. Like, you know, after, like, Trump didn't help his credibility on COVID with some of the things he said early on. So I was skeptical about anything Trump said. You know what I mean? Yeah, now, and we started getting more information on the vaccine. And it wasn't, honestly, I wasn't going to get it until like some medical professionals that I personally knew were like, yo, you need to get the vax.
Like who?
You know, I mean, my wife is a nurse. A couple other people I know are doctors. I got a friend who's a doctor at the VA. They were like, yo, it's good. You need to get it. I'm getting it. Once I found they were getting it. And then I found out, you know, because there was all this stuff about it's trying to kill Black people. And then like, you know, I found out that the woman who developed the vaccines is a Black woman. You know, I was like, all right, I'm going to get it.
But this goes, what you're saying, Jason, though, is the fundamental issue in American politics, which is we distrust our institutions so much that we turn to radical positions or we'll take up crazy ideas because the ones that they're giving us, we're so used to them lying to us. Right. I mean, where do you think Trump comes from? Trump is an expression of anger at the establishment, right? He gets elected. Like, no, a healthy country doesn't elect Donald Trump. An unhealthy one that distrusts its institutions says, screw you, I'm sending in the Undertaker. I'm sending in this guy to smack you around.
Yep. And the thing that I hate now too is the hatred and wishing death on people who are unvaccinated is this one of the most sickening things I've seen, you know, because you're allowed to have your own position, but you know, I have a family member who doesn't want to get the vax. They believe that it's, you know, they, you know, whatever. But, and it's a good human being. It's a great human being. And you look at my family history and what the government did to them and poisoned, you know, their children and this and that. And so they're not trying to do it. And she's, she's not invited to a Christmas party with her side of it. Like, it's crazy stuff going on. And then, like, when I go on Twitter, it's like, oh, when somebody dies unvaxxed, they're like, good, they deserve it, they should die, you know, don't let them in the hospital, they should die. And it's like, yo, you people are sick. Like say somebody's ignorant and wrong, so should they die because they're ignorant and wrong? They deserve to die because they were misled into believing that the vax isn't good, if you know, like, whether it's good or bad. I'm just saying, say it is good and they should have took it. If they're wrong and ignorant, they should die because of that. It's just right. So disgusting.
Yeah.
Right now.
Yeah.
Right. And then, you know, I remember so recently there was this dude. It was a guy, I think he was like a state senator in Washington State or Oregon or something like that. And he was against the vax. And then he went to El Salvador for some reason, for some trip, came back and got COVID. And he was looking for monoclonal antibodies or whatever. I think it was too late at that point. And then he died. And there were a bunch of people who celebrated. Were like, what's that?
They celebrated, I bet you, right?
Yeah, no. So I posted it on Twitter and I was like, look, you know, I can't remember exactly what I said, but it was something, like I said, I always try to be Mr. Love, Empathy and all of that. Mm-hmm. So I was like, you know, please consider getting the vaccine. Like, don't wait until your family gets affected like his. And there were some comments like, yo, screw him. You know, he got what he deserved. And I'm like, yo, this guy had two kids. You know what I mean? Little kids, two little daughters, you know, had a wife. I'm like, yo, like, all right, he made a bad decision. That doesn't mean, you know, that he deserved to be in that position. And certainly doesn't mean that his daughters deserve to grow up without a father. You know what I mean?
The government has lied to us about what's, you know, about, you can't say everything, but I mean, they lie to us constantly, nonstop since its existence. And the pharmaceutical industry has been, you know, poisoning us, killing us, making money off of us since their existence.
With the government, with the government helping them do it. Yeah, I mean, the whole OxyContin thing, and it was like literally like you've got like corrupt people at the FDA signing off on the opioid crisis, and like they're all in on the deal.
Exactly. And then Rudy Giuliani, who you've rapped about, Rudy Giuliani being the big defender of OxyContin. He was the one.
Yeah, I didn't even know that.
Yeah, man. He was the one that they sent out to kind of smooth things over. This is back when he was America's mayor, and they started getting a little bit of attention from, you know, I don't know if it was the DEA or whoever it was like, yo, this is shady.
Does anybody have the numbers on that? How many dead per year? Because
usually the drug overdoses kill about 70,000 a year, which is more than died in the whole Vietnam War, actually. And in the United States this year, it's now over 100,000 who died of the opioid crisis.
Yep. I'm not the kid from the ghetto. I'm as middle class gets, you know, particularly for a black family, I'm as middle class as it gets.
He's underselling himself. He's a pretty high class dude, actually.
Yeah, I'm classy. You know, and now I grew up very middle class, but either way, in a middle class suburb, in a middle class house. And I'll say this, like, I've lost 4 friends to usually to heroin, but heroin or opioids.
Yep.
A lot of them were, you know, majority of them were white too. They weren't even black dudes, it's white kids. And one of them was wealthy, not poor, not middle class, wealthy. We used to go over to his house because he had a swimming pool.
They were probably getting him drugs from the doctor. And then when that dried up, they went, you know, to the next, you know.
Right.
And,
yeah, I think he had a gallbladder surgery or something like that.
Long Island, the opiate crisis and the heroin, you know, hit Long Island crazy. Everybody's dying off of it. Everybody. It's crazy. It's like so much death out there.
But again, I also hear the side because, look, I've been in a hospital in Baltimore. You want to talk about the race element here. I've been in a hospital in Baltimore with my cousin who was going through a heroin overdose, right? And the way we got treated, you know, again, I was young, you know, had the long braids, you know, the long cornrows and baggy clothes, you know, it was, you know, that era. And the way we were getting talked to by the nurses and treated, you know, like straight garbage. And I look at that. There was no empathy for kids, for people who got heroin.
Particularly
for black people in Baltimore. Baltimore was never, you know, we had our crack cocaine moment, but Baltimore has always been a heroin city. Like, and heroin has always been big in Baltimore.
Help. It's so hard to get help. You want to get a clinic, you want to get that. I mean, it's so hard. You get a heroin addict or a drug addict, and especially in certain places, it's family members sitting there, you know, half dead, looking like zombies, and you want to save them. You want, come, you know, and it's like, oh, this is a waiting list for this. This doesn't exist, you know, boom, boom, boom. You got to say, oh, maybe you got to move out of state to an unpopular area to try to get help somewhere else. It's like, they don't address it at all either. Yeah. You talk about all the other tragedies in the world, and you're saying we lose 100,000 people a year. Like, why isn't that, you know, news, you know, every night? Why aren't we talking about 100,000 people dying a year from something and ways to get help and how to fix it? Like, we don't talk about that either, you know?
But here's the thing is, like, it feels a lot for someone like me who has seen that and seen how it went down. Seeing how that went down in that time period. Like, it seems like there's so much empathy now for drug addiction, particularly from the prescription drugs. And it wasn't there. It hasn't been there. It wasn't there with crack. It wasn't there with heroin, with Black folks. As a matter of fact, it led to more demonization, more, you know, to tougher laws and all of that. So for a lot of us, it's kind of cynical when the right wing is like, oh, opioids. When it wasn't there for my cousin, they were putting him in jail. You know what I mean? And he was never a drug dealer, at least not a big one.
Chappelle had a good skit on that, a good stand-up about that. He was making fun of the white boys on meth, because, hey, when crack, yo, oh, yeah. And he, right. He had a good, you look it up. I'm misquoting it, but he had a funny thing about it.
Yeah, because he lives out there in Ohio, I think.
Yeah, he's like, well, you didn't care about us in the 80s. Now he said something.
Yeah. Although, in fairness to your point before, RA is like, we're talking about it. Occasionally gets a little bit of attention. Washington's not talking about it. Like, the major news outlets aren't talking about it. It's actually a sleeper story. 100,000 dead is a lot of people.
Yeah. Well, I think the number, but I think
it's the pharmaceutical industry's fault. And, you know, they're all in bed with the pharmaceutical industry. So, you know, why villainize their, you know, people who they're supposed to champion?
Yeah. All right. Well, I think we've used a lot of your time today, RA. I'm very appreciative of you spending some time with us. Kind of cool to get a chance to talk to you and meet you. I appreciate that.
Hey, thank you for having me. Like I said, what's the producer's name that contacted me to be on this?
Richie.
Yeah, Richie hit me up. I took a screenshot. I sent it to my boy. I said, is this a hit piece? Is this going to be some smear me? You know, because after I did that right wing YouTube show, you know, people, all these crazy racist people came at me going crazy. So I sent it to my boy. He's like, yo, that network, they might try to do a hit piece. But I was like, hey, what are you going to do? Try to hit me, you know? But you guys were a pleasure. I had a great time, great conversation. This is the way it should be, you know? So
no doubt. Yo, RA, definitely I want to get back together with you and talk hip-hop and boxing and all of that. We need to do a hip-hop and boxing podcast. You know what I'm saying? We could pitch it to the Daily Caller. I seriously think, you know, I would love to do that. So, you know, I'll get your contact. Thank you for coming on.
What is the Daily Caller, actually? Excuse my ignorance.
So it is a website, usually leans with right-wing material, but it's a news website. And you know, we're trying to have a little bit of balance and bring in a larger audience. And so that's one of the reasons that Vince and I decided to do this podcast. But you can, of course, go to the dailycaller.com and get your daily news, just like
if we're gonna do a boxing and rap show and least watched show in the history of the website, you know.
Hey, we're building some things. I'm gonna holler at you for real. I'm gonna holler at you, and we're building some different things, some different outlets that I think will get a different audience. So we'll talk about that. I definitely want to holler at you off air, but thank you to the legendary loser, my man, RA the Rugged Man, who has been very gracious with his time. You can find him on Twitter. Send him all the love that he deserves as an artist who's been in the game for 3 decades, dropping bombs. Definitely thank you, Vince Colonnaise. And thank all of you who watch. You can watch us on YouTube, Facebook Watch, and certainly find us on the audio podcast, anywhere that podcasts are platformed. We really appreciate all of your support. Keep supporting us. All 12 of you, we love you. All right, peace.